Using hand-carved rubber stamps when you create is a way to add unique imagery to your work. Today we'll use Speedball's Speedy Carve and Speedy Cut block materials, taking advantage of the properties of each. This is really simple, but eminently satisfying. Let's begin by talking about these two carving materials and the differences between them, because there are differences besides the two colors that you see. This is Speedy Cut. It's a little bit thicker and it's definitely a softer material than the pink Speedy Carve. Now, having said that, they both work, but obviously there are going to be some circumstances where one is going to be preferable over the other, and we'll talk about that. And we're also going to talk about something very different that you can do with this that you certainly cannot with the Speedy Carve. This is the number one lino set. It comes with this handle, and I've already got one of the blades in here, and it has this variety of blades. You can take this end off the handle, you store the bits in there so that you don't lose them when you're not actually actively using this. Now, the white Speedy Cut is definitely softer than the pink Speedy Carve. In fact, you're going to see this is a skinny little piece of leftover Speedy Carve, and I'm tugging on it pretty well, and it hasn't snapped yet. This is Speedy Cut, and you can see how easily I can break this apart. And you'll also notice that this is crumbly. That's one of the criticisms that you'll hear people say, is that Speedy Cut is really crumbly. And while that's true, it does offer us some advantages that the Speedy Carve won't. So let's talk for a second about the variety of things that you're going to see me doing here and about the way that you can go ahead and get your design on the block material. And you have a couple of different options. You can do what I did here, which is to simply go ahead and grab a pencil and just go ahead and draw on there. Or you can freehand it, which is really all I did here. I just used the knife and I carved grooves in here to make a simple vertical line design. Or you can do this, which is to draw with, and I like to use a number two pencil. You draw with this pencil on a piece of paper, you turn it over and you get your design centered on the block, and then you pick up your pencil and you're just going to come back and you're going to scribble over those lines. And what that's going to do is actually transfer the design. And this works on both of these varieties. It works on the Speedy Carve and on the Speedy Cut. I just happen to be showing you on the Speedy Cut. So you're just going to go ahead and scribble over these lines, and you're essentially just going to trace the design right onto the block material. And you can reuse this multiple times. And there it is. And really, you don't need anything darker than that. But if you feel as though this might rub off while you're working on it, you can come in. I like to use a pit pen. You can either use a big fat tip like this just so that you can see what you're doing. And you just can come and trace these lines. Or you can use a brush tip pit pen. I've used them both. It's one, six of one, half a dozen of the other. And now I know that these lines aren't actually going to rub off at all. Oops. And I think I might put one more vein up there. So once you have your design on here, it's time to start thinking about cutting, and that's what we're going to talk about next. Though there are five blades included in the number one lino set, I typically find myself using either the number one or the number two. Occasionally, if I have a lot of area that I want to dig out, I'll use the number five blade, which is very big and very broad. But for the most part, I'm working with the one and the two. And these are actually really easy to do, to put them in here. If you look inside this handle, you'll see that there are two rings in there. And basically, all you do is you slip the blade in between the two of them, you tighten it, and then you're good to go. And you loosen it this way to take it out. It's very, very straightforward. Now, when you work with either of these, obviously you probably want to start with the outline and the detail. That's generally how I do mine. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to cut the outline on this, and then I'll do the detail, and then I'll just remove some of the back of this. So when I do this, what I'm going to do is start with the number one blade, and I'm just going to follow my design here. So it's just a question of getting the blade in the material and pushing it along so that you can follow this edge. Now, generally, I turn the block and the cutter. I find that I get smoother curves that way, and you'll practice and play a little bit to figure out what works the best for you. Now, again, we talk about the speedy cut being crumbly, and you can see these sort of crumbles that happen here. Now, I could actually do this with the number two blade, and in fact, I'm probably going to pop this out, and I'm going to put this one in just to show you the difference, the difference between the two of them. So I'll come over here, and you can see that this is a fairly shallow cut, and it certainly has its uses, and we'll talk about that. But if I put this number two blade in now, I'm actually going to take a bigger bite out of this, and I'm going to cut a deeper and wider channel with this blade than I did with the number one. Again, they both have their uses. It's just a question of figuring out what you want to do. So for this, I'm probably going to use this number two blade, and I could also come in and I could actually, I want to show you one thing, and this will help me kill two birds with one stone. You start with blocks like this, or even bigger ones, because they're both available in larger chunks too, but you have to find a way to hack small enough pieces off. And so what I typically do, let me bring this in, I work with a cutting mat, my knife, and a, this is not an X-Acto knife, this is a utility knife. I find this far more effective than trying to use an X-Acto knife, which is just not big enough. So I'm going to extend this blade all the way, and you can either cut freehand, and you see the speedy cut cuts very easily. The speedy carve is a little bit denser, and so you have to push a little bit harder to get a piece cut off of that, but they both will work. And if you want a straight edge, like I've done here, you can use your Omnigrid ruler and one of these utility knives to cut nice straight lines. But what I can do now is I can actually cut away some of this background. That just gives me less to have to carve away after the fact. So that's how you can take big pieces, you can take workable size pieces off of your larger pieces, or you can just go ahead and use the utility knife to sort of chunk off some pieces. Let me get this out of the way, bring my knife back in. And so what I can do is I can either use this number two blade to clear this out, or I can go ahead and I can use that number five blade. But what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to cut this center vein with the number two blade, and I'm not going to press super hard because I don't want a really fat area to be removed, but I do want something a little bit bigger than what the number one will do. So I'm just going to gently push my way along and take that piece out, and I actually think I'm going to use the number two blade. I was thinking I might shift to the number one, but as long as I'm careful and I don't push too hard, I'm not going to take a big divot out of here, and this will be fine. One of the things to bear in mind is that the line that you're cutting, the groove that you're cutting, will actually print bigger than what it looks like when you look at it. So you'll experience this as you go along. You'll think, oh geez, that ended up being far bigger than what I had in mind. And so you'll have to either recut or start again or just live with it the way that it is. All right, so there are my veins cut out now. And I'm going to switch out, and I'm going to put in this number five blade because I want to use it to remove some of this other material. And again, with the speedy cut, this is very easy to do because this is such soft material. Now, what I'm doing is I'm cutting away all of this background, so I'm just going to get, it's going to be difficult to explain, but you'll see when I print this or when I stamp with it what I actually end up with. It's not going to look the way that you think, and this is one of the things that you have to bear in mind when you are deciding what to cut away and what to leave. So let me just, in fact, I'm going to come in with my utility knife and just cut some of this away. I think I've got enough of this out of here. So I'm just going to brush this to one side. I just want to kind of knock those crumbs out of the way, because if there are any sitting on top of this, it's going to print. And when I'm playing, when I'm working on a design, what I like to do is use black stays on. It's going to do two things. It's going to help me see what this looks like when I go ahead and print it, and it's also going to show me any areas where I might actually have to come back and remove some material. So I'm going to print this, and you see what I get is a full leaf. I'm not going to get an outline, which is what you might have thought originally, and that was what I was alluding to earlier. So I'm going to get this leaf, and I'm going to get obviously the veins that I put in here. Now you can see right here that my vein doesn't go all the way to the edge, and that can either be a mistake that needs to be corrected, or that can just be a design element. It's really up to you. But what I can see when I look here, let me just put the lid back on this, I can see that I've got some areas that printed when I did this. So I want to come back in, and you can see them right there. I want to come back in and very carefully remove that area, and I can see the black here that needs to go. Now sometimes when you do this and you get these grooves and these sort of stripes that happen, and let me see if I can find the stamp that I'm thinking of. All right, so this is a different leaf, and I did this one on Speedy Carve. And you can see these lines here, and when this prints, I'd actually decided to leave them here. And oftentimes you'll see hand-carved stamps with this sort of business going on in the background. And let me just show you the difference here. And that's actually part of the, whoops, I missed, part of the attraction sometimes with hand-carved stamps is that you see what goes on there in the background, and you get that print that kind of goes on, and you get this speckled area. Some people like that, some people don't. I actually really like that look. Now, if I had done a little bit better job about thinking about that, I actually could have left some of these other lines a little bit taller so that they would have printed too. But coming back to our white stamp here on the Speedy Cut, now that I've cleaned this up, and I think I'm going to leave that vein the way that it is, now that I've cleaned this up, this should actually print a lot more cleanly than it did a second ago. Just get that out of there. All right, so let's, again, I just want to brush my little crumbly bits off. Just come in and print this again and see what this looks like now. Yes, and that's better, but you can see what I've got going on here. Any of the crumbles that get on the surface of this stamp will cause this kind of business going on. Now, if I wanted to, I could put some sort of design in this side of the leaf if I wanted. I could put another group of veins in there, and I may do that. But I want to move on now to working on the Speedy Carve and this piece someplace here that I have going on. This is a piece that's actually a lot curvier, and I need to switch this back out to the number two blade. This is a lot curvier than the one that we worked on a moment ago, that leaf, and it can present a little bit more challenge. But it's one of those things that if you just take your time, and again, the difference between the Speedy Carve, this pink stuff, and that white Speedy Cut stuff, is that the Speedy Carve is not going to cut quite so readily as the Speedy Cut, sorry. it's definitely a firmer, denser material. And I'm going to bring in my X-Acto knife, and I will use this at times. I'm just going to sort of cut that last little piece. I find it's easier to get straight lines using this. There we go. But because this is a denser material, you have to exert a little bit more pressure to get it to cut. Again, I'll bring in the X-Acto knife just to trim this end off. But it does allow you to get far finer detail without that crumbling business that we saw going on just a moment ago. So when you decide what you want to work with, you have to think about how detailed your design is going to be, and maybe you have arthritis, and so working with the Speedy Cut is a far better choice for you because it cuts so much simpler. And you can do all kinds of really fun things here, and you can do basically the same thing with either one of these. Again, you're going to get a little bit more crumbly stuff going on here and maybe a little bit less fine detail, but either one of these will work. And then you can do some really cool stuff, and you'll notice how fairly perfect this heart shape is and how fairly perfect this circle is. There is a method to my madness. I'm going to show you how easy it is to do this. Serendipity can be a pretty fabulous thing, and I happened upon this technique simply because it occurred to me. I couldn't even tell you what the thought process was that got me here, but it's here and it's really worth using. It's a really interesting, fun thing that you can do. These are fondant cutters, and they are made of metal, and while this is not sharp per se, it is enough to actually make its way through the speedy cut. Not the speedy carve. In fact, I'll just work with this piece. I don't want to ruin this piece. I'm going to put this on here, and I'm going to press, and I had to press really hard to get through that little tiny bit, but look what happens when I work with the speedy carve. Now, I'm not going to press this with my fingers because it's a little bit harder to get it in evenly. This is just another OmniGrid ruler. All you need is something flat and firm that won't flex, so you can put it on the top of the cutter and push it down. And you can get right through this speedy cut with no difficulty. And out pops the fondant cutter, and then you're just going to push the piece through. Now remember, this is speedy cut and it's crumbly, but that's okay. You just brush these crumbles off, get them out of the way, because again, if they get up here, they're going to interfere with how the block prints. But once you get them done, you have this perfect little square with these rounded corners. And it works for all of these. Just push that through, pop it out, brush off the crumbles. Now, you can use this as is. These are pretty small pieces, but it doesn't mean you can't do something to them. Here is the little flower. And all I did was just put a center on it. So you can do most anything with these, again, within the limited confines of these small ones. But when these fondant cutters are sold, they're typically sold in sets of, I don't know if it's three or four, and they kind of nest, so you get two, three, four, however many sizes you get. So you have these larger pieces, and again, I want to be reasonably economical how I use this. There's no point in wasting it. I'm just going to press this through. Pop this out. Again, I'm going to brush off all the crumbles, get them out of there. And I have this pretty darn near perfect circle. Now, okay, that's a little boring, you're thinking. Well, it's not boring if you do something to it. This was one I actually did by hand. I didn't do it with the fondant cutter. But you can see the kind of fun things that you can do. And we're talking about nothing that's rocket science here. Again, I have my number two cutter. I'm not even going to mark this. I'm just going to make some kind of curvy lines on here. All I want to do is create something that's my own imagery that I can use on the background of my journal pages or whatever it is that I'm working on so that I get some really cool texture on there. Whoops, let me get that done. There we go. So I get some really cool texture on there that, again, is kind of mine and maybe won't look like yours. And you have the opportunity to play and get really creative, and you can do all kinds of fun things here. And again, this is carving stuff is really straightforward. I know it seems like I didn't show you how to do very much, but honest to goodness, there isn't a whole heck of a lot to show you. Whether you start with something that you freehand, like we talked about, or you trace the design on the block like we did for this leaf, or you're just playing like I'm doing here. It's just a matter of experimenting with the particular cutters and the size of the groove that it makes, and just playing. And you'll find what works for you. Does turning the piece work when you're making curves, or does turning the handle? Now, I find that this gets very awkward, which is why I turn the piece. So maybe I'm just going to put some little divots in here. Nothing fancy. Just going to put some kind of texture and some marks in here. Then I'm going to print this and see what it looks like. Maybe it's great. Maybe it needs a little bit more work. I don't know. We'll see. Put a piece right there. All right. So let me just grab a piece of paper. And again, I like to test print with black stays on. I just find that it's far more effective for me this way. There's probably some crumbles on here, but that's all right. We'll at least see what this looks like. Yep, there was definitely a big crumble on there. So let me wipe this off rather, and ink it up again, and then we'll see what this looks like. Okay, that's better. Again, there's nothing planned or nothing particularly special going on here. I just want to show you how simple this is. Now, here's the best part. See how thick the speedy cut is? You can work on both sides. If I want to come back and I want to put a design on this side, I can do that. Let me cover this. I can just sort of follow, let me get this paper out of here, too hard to swivel. I can just follow the outline of my circle. And I can complete the circle, get that out of there. And maybe what I'll do now is I'll come in and I'll do a spiral. Again, for me, the way that my hands work, I find it far easier to turn the piece than I do to try to turn my wrist to get curves. You'll play and experiment and you'll figure out what works for you. Again, this is super simple. It's fun to do, and it allows you to have imagery on your pages or whatever your project is that is uniquely yours. And while I have no objection to using commercial stamps, I love commercial stamps, sometimes it's nice to be able to do your own thing and say, yep, I did that. Now, black stays on is not the only thing that we can work with. Next, I'm going to show you how to use the Dilutions ink spray pads to get some really cool, colorful patterning. It pretty much goes without saying that you can use whatever ink pad or colors you want, but with the advent of the Dilutions ink spray pad and all of these fabulous colorways and this combination of colors, you can kind of get multicolor stamping with virtually no effort at all. This ink pad has Funky Fuchsia, Calypso Teal, and Fresh Lime on it, and what I'm going to do is just use this stamp that I carved earlier, and I'm going to pick up color. I'm just going to kind of ink this up. Let me get this out of the way. I'm going to ink this up, come in here. I'm just going to stamp this on the border. Now, not a lot of strong contrast there, but you'll see what I'm going to do with this in a second that's actually going to change the way that this looks. But first I need to get this stamped all the way across the bottom of this page. Now, if I wanted to, let me bring this back in, if I wanted to actually come over here and start picking up different colors, I could do that, but for now I'm going to go with sort of this same repeat that I'm working on. Move this out of the way, come in here, and get this last length of the border done. Now I'm going to put the stamp to one side, I'm going to close up that pad, and I'm going to bring in my heat tool because I just want to dry this off. Okay, I think that's good. So now I'm going to use, I have a black pit pen in the F fine tip, and I have my Unisigno pen. I'm actually going to turn this like this. It's easier for me to work in this direction when I'm making these kind of loopy things. So I'm just going to come in here, and I'm basically outlining my stamped design. That kind of helps it stand off against the background, since these colors are somewhat similar. I didn't do a very good join right there, but I'm just sort of mushing it all together and no one will be the wiser. Again, this is not supposed to be perfect. Anything that's handmade, at least in my mind, part of the joy is that it's not perfect, and the variations that come with each iteration as you make something or as you create something totally new means that they're not going to be perfect, and I'm absolutely okay with that. But by coming along and outlining with this marker, it means that I'm really delineating the outline of these designs or these shapes, and it really makes it stand up off that background. So now what I'm going to do, actually, before I do this, I'm going to put a circle sort of at the top of each one of these upward spokes, and I won't go all the way across because you really don't need to see me draw circles. It's kind of like watching paint dry. But then I'm going to just come in and I'm going to touch this pen, and I'm just going to lightly dot to fill in this circle. And so now this sort of takes on an entirely different look. Okay, so you sort of get what's going on there. And obviously, let me bring in a different colorway. This is Lemon Zest, Post Box Red, and Funky Fuchsia. And this is actually a tag left over from when I did the video about this ink spray pad. I've got this on one side, and there's actually nothing on the other. But I want to grab some of these other stamps and just show you how cool they look when you bring in the notion of this multicolor pad. So let's do this house, because I really like houses. I think it's a fun piece of imagery. And so I'm going to span two colors. All right, that looks like it's pretty well inked. And then I'll just stamp this. And there you have it. You have this house. Now again, you can see the black from where I previously stamped this with black stays on. This is where I'm going to get those carving lines in here. If you don't want those, obviously then you have to go back and carve them all out and get rid of them. But here is this leaf that we did a little bit earlier. Let's see what this looks like. Very pretty. I like that a lot. And again, this starts to look like a fall leaf because I've got this gradation of color. And again, I can just close this and get this out of the way. I can come in and dry this off. Come back with a pit pen and outline these items, and now they really take on an entirely different look. Very different. Oops. Of course, I'm working upside down, so that's why I'm making such a mess. At least that's my story, and I'm sticking with it. So, you know, you work with these hand-carved stamps. You create imagery that's genuinely your own. Even if you do something, the same thing that I'm doing, it's your version of it. It's your imagery, and that allows you the freedom to create whatever you want, and you can make all kinds of really fun things. I am just going to bring in, because these fascinate me, these that I did with the fondant cutters, I think are so cool. Even just this little square one here, if I don't go ahead and put anything on it, and if I could find that flower one, which I had here, here it is, let's just see, and I don't know, this is so small, it might not print. I might need something like black stays on, but let's see what that looks like. Oh no, that prints too. And again, you can get the color variation depending on how you, let me bring this in so you can see it. You can see I'm kind of spanning two colors there, and I kind of got the orange and the yellow. So again, this is just so much fun. You have all this imagery that's your own. You have the opportunity to bring in all these really fun colors, and you can create all kinds of really cool bits that you can embellish. Wow, I like that. You can embellish your journal pages with, your cards, all kinds of fun things. Carving stamps is really easy. You saw how quickly I had this done today, and it's something that pretty much anyone can do. Throw in the fondant cutters, and you have a whole different kettle of fish to play with. I hope you have as much fun working with this as I did.